Next speaker, Gerard Cassenti, from our partners at Columbia University. I will put your slides up so they're ready to go whenever you're ready.
Okay. Thank you, Morten, for the introduction. Thank you for the invitation to come to Copenhagen. And I'll try to make a link into something that is not intuitively obvious, which is embryogenesis, between a link between embryogenesis and aging through the control of homeostasis. So I don't think I need to introduce embryogenesis. Everybody knows what it is. However, I think there is a need to introduce exactly what is homeostasis, and it is the assembly of physiological processes that are needed by living organisms to maintain body temperature and blood concentration of water, oxygen, glucose, protein, fat, salt, that are compatible with life. So, by definition, one definition possible of aging is a disruption of homeostasis, and this is an obvious definition. So, one organ that, it's not the only one, but one organ that plays a major role in the maintenance of homeostasis is adrenal gland, that is made of two parts, the cortex of the adrenal gland and the medulla of the adrenal gland. And the cortex of the adrenal gland, what we will speak about today, secretes two hormones in mice and three in primates, aldosterone, a mineralocorticoid hormone, and the glucocorticoid hormones. The medulla secretes catecholamine, which are adrenaline, noradrenaline, and are not necessarily trivial molecules when it comes to the control of homeostasis. So, among all the organs that control homeostasis, I would say the adrenal gland is one of the most important ones. Aldosterone is a mineralocorticoid hormone. I will go through its regulation later, but its function is to regulate potassium excretion and the volume of extracellular fluid in our body, essentially blood pressure. So blood pressure is a fundamental parameter of life and of homeostasis. And that's the only function of aldosterone, and I say only function by comparison to its partner in crime, glucocorticoid hormone, corticosterone in rodents, cortisol in primates, that regulate few functions. And in fact, you could tell that cortisol regulates most physiological processes in the body that I know of, sometimes mildly, sometimes profoundly, but there is no physiological process that escapes the regulation of cortisol. One of them is bone formation. Cortisol promotes bone formation, and strangely enough, it inhibits the expression of the quintessential marker of bone formation, which is osteocalcin. So, this is one of the hallmarks in bone biology. Cortisol inhibits osteocalcin, and in fact, clinicians that take care of patients with Cushing disease that makes too much cortisol don't measure cortisol anymore. They just measure osteocalcin to know if the treatment is active. But it raises a question, why does cortisol inhibit osteocalcin? And if osteocalcin is really a hormone, then the question takes another sense. Could it be that osteocalcin regulates cortisol? And so you can ask this question in loss of function model, and you can also ask it in gain of function model. The advantage of the gain of function model, there are not many, but one of them is that you can do it in many multiple animal species. So when we inject osteocalcin in mice, what we see is that there is an increase in circulating corticosterone that is of the same extent than the similar molar amount of the hypothalamic pituitary axis hormone will incur. This starts after 2 hours post-injection and lasts for 24 hours. So that fulfills the hypothesis or verifies the hypothesis that, in fact, glucocorticoid inhibits osteocalcin because osteocalcin is a stimulator of the glucocorticoid synthesis. The surprise came when we look at aldosterone and we realize that osteocalcin also increases aldosterone in blood. And usually, as I will show you later, the regulation of expression and synthesis of these two hormones is achieved through different means. So that was an unexpected result. It's true, in acute injection, you inject into the calcium, you see aldosterone going up fourfold for 24 hours. It's also true in monkeys. If you inject osteocalcin in monkeys, which is a surrogate for human, you increase osteocalcin, you increase cortisol, and you increase aldosterone. Okay, so this regulation most likely is conserved between rodents and primates, and most likely including human. It does not affect the third steroid hormone that is made only by the adrenal gland, that is made only by the primates, which is sulfate of dehydroepiandrosterone. So osteocalcin regulates, the synthesis of the adrenal steroid hormone is a pathway starting with cholesterol, and that includes two key enzymes. One is called CYP11B1, that makes cortisol or corticosterone. And the other one is called CYP11B2, or aldosterone synthase, that transforms cortisol into aldosterone. And what we observed in mice in which we injected osteocalcin, or in a gain-of-function model, is that osteocalcin favors the expression of CYP11B1 and B2, the two enzymes needed to make the hormones. And it also increases the expression of the receptor of ACTH. I will maybe briefly touch upon it later. So, where does osteocalcin act to regulate adrenal steroidogenesis? It's not a trivial question, because if you look at the regulation of cortisol, or glucocorticoid, it starts in the hypothalamus. It goes to the pituitary gland to make ACTH, that signals in adrenal gland to make cortisol. And for aldosterone, it's even more complex. There is no hypothalamic pituitary axis. There is a kidney, liver, lung, adrenal axis that results in the synthesis of aldosterone. And so what you see is that of the only organ that is common between these two axes is the adrenal gland. So we look where, to address this question, where does osteocalcin act? We look at where is the receptor of osteocalcin expressed. There are two receptors for osteocalcin. One of them, GPRC6A, is not expressed in any structure involved in adrenal steroid hormone synthesis. The other one, GPR158, which is a brain-specific receptor, is also expressed in the adrenal gland and not in the kidney or pituitary gland. GPR158 is expressed in cells of the cortex. It's not expressed in cells of the medulla. It's expressed in cells that make cortisol and in cells in red that makes aldosterone, glomerulosa cells. As I said, it's not expressed in the CRH, in the hypothalamic neurons that control cortisol synthesis, or in pituitary cells that make ACTH, or in kidney cells that make renin, the initiator of the regulation of aldosterone. So it seems, and it was likely to be the case, that osteocalcin acts in one organ, the adrenal gland, to regulate adrenal steroidogenesis. In view of these results, we generated mice that lack the receptor of osteocalcin in adrenal cortex with SF1-CRI. Unfortunately, SF1 is a transcription factor that is also expressed in hypothalamus and pituitary, and I will address this constraint during the talk. And what we observe in these mice is that they have a decrease in expression of GPR158, but it's not an abolition of, it's a loss, it's a hypomorph. And this hypomorph have a 50% decrease in corticosterone in blood and a 20% decrease in aldosterone in blood. They have a decrease in expression of the two genes, CP11B1 and CP11B2. Whereas the genes that are upstream of the adrenal gland, CRH in the hypothalamus, ACTH in the pituitary, or renin, are not decreased, and if not, sometimes they are increased, indicating that indeed it is in the adrenal gland that osteocalcin signals. I'm not going to show negative data, but we did a neuron-specific knockout of GPR158, and adrenal functions are absolutely normal in these mice. So it seems like a relatively simple story. There is an hormone that regulates two more hormones, and that's all we are going to show. And so we decided to look at mice that like osteocalcin, and we generated these mice like everybody else would do by crossing heterozygous parents and obtaining osteocalcin null mice that were wild type. They have absolutely normal adrenal functions. So there are a couple of possibilities to explain this phenotype, or lack of phenotype. One is that, in fact, osteocalcin is not the endogenous ligand of GPR158 in the adrenal gland, and that there is another ligand that regulates adrenal steroidogenesis. There are two reasons to believe that this is not the case. The first one is that if we inject osteocalcin in GPR158 null mice, there is no increase in adrenal steroidogenesis, which is a pretty strong argument. But the second one is even stronger. If we do compound heterozygous mice that lack one allele of osteocalcin and one allele of GPR158, we reproduce the adrenal insufficiency, indicating that, yet, osteocalcin is the endogenous ligand of GPR158. So, if it is the endogenous ligand of 158 and adult mice obtained by crossing heterozygous parents don't have a phenotype, it could be that this is a phenotype that is caused by lactation. And if it is the case, osteocalcin null mice that will have been nursed by osteocalcin plus minus mice should have low osteocalcin. I'm sorry. Osteocalcin null pups that are fed by osteocalcin het mother should have osteocalcin in blood, and they don't. Osteocalcin does not go through the milk in mice, like it is the case also in human. There is no osteocalcin in milk. It could be, and it is the most likely explanation, that it is a parental effect, and if the parents are homozygous, then the mice will be null. And apparently it's the case, if the mother are osteocalcin null, then the pups are adrenal insufficient. On the other hand, if the father is adrenal osteocalcin null, the progeny is normal. That does not prove that it is a maternal effect. It does only prove that it is a developmental effect. It could be maternal or it could be embryonic. And if it was embryonic, osteocalcin heterozygote mice, adult mice, born from osteocalcin null mothers should have normal adrenal function. And that's exactly what we observed. So it's embryonic osteocalcin that drives adrenal steroidogenesis throughout life. And in fact, if we look at when osteocalcin is present in blood, it appears in the blood of the embryo around E14 to 15.5. And if we take osteocalcin null mother and inject them with osteocalcin once a day between E14.5 and birth, their progeny osteocalcin null at adulthood is normal. So it's purely an effect that occurs between the last 3 days of development but lasts throughout life after that. So as I told you, adrenal glands are masters of homeostasis, and through these two hormones, and catecholamine are out of the picture here. And so we ask if, in fact, the function, the homeostatic function regulated by adrenal glands were affected in homozygote osteocalcin null mice born from homozygote parents or heterozygote parents, and the same thing for the receptors. And there are many functions. We looked at functions that we knew were not regulated by osteocalcin. So if you look at a blood potassium concentration, which is very dangerous and it's a way to kill people, it's extremely increased in mice that lack the receptor in adrenal gland. This is an important model because the mother in this cross does not have the Cre, is wild type. This is a demonstration that it is a purely embryonic effect. It is decreased in a gain-of-function model that I did not introduce you for osteocalcin. It is profoundly increased in homozygote mice born from homozygote parents. And it is totally normal in homozygotes born from heterozygote parents. So embryonic osteocalcin regulates at least one physiological function that postnatal osteocalcin does not. And this physiological function is a life-surviving function. The same is true for blood pressure. In the absence of osteocalcin signaling, blood pressure systolic and diastolic is low. If there is too much osteocalcin, it is high. Again, it is a function that is simply of embryonic osteocalcin. Osteocalcin mice born from heterozygote parents do have normal blood pressure. Glucocorticoid hormones are involved in ways that are not clear in the acute stress response, and they are also involved, as you know, in the regulation of osteocalcin. So in mice that are homosteocalcin null mice born from heterozygote parents, glucocorticoid hormone goes up during stress normally. But in mice that lacked embryonic osteocalcin, glucocorticoid hormone doesn't go nearly as much up as it does in wild-type mice or in mice that were born from heterozygote parents. So, adrenal development is very close to the definition of a nightmare, so I'm going to simplify it. There are three types of cells: fetal cells that express this transcription factor, SF1, progenitor cells that express another transcription factor, GLI1, and hormone-making cells that express, again, SF1. All these cells, as you will see, express GPR158. At E14.5, always there is no phenotype. At E16.5, what we see is that the expression of the endogenous of the steroid genes is decreased. The expression of GLI1 is gone, so there is no progenitor cells. There is much less SF1 expression. And at E 18.5. SF1 is much decreased. There is no expression of the enzyme-making gene, making hormones. GLI1 is profoundly decreased, and as well as CB1. So what osteocalcin does is to act on all aspects of adrenal steroidogenesis. As a result, it also affects cell proliferation and the glands of homozygote mice born from homozygote parents are smaller because the expression of markers of cell proliferation is decreased. And this decrease in size that is seen in embryo will remain throughout life. So, in a nutshell, what the function of osteocalcin is, it's necessary for adrenal development. Even though mice have a normal HPA axis, if they don't have osteocalcin, there will be no appropriate adrenal development because it affects all stages of development. And it makes adrenal steroid hormone and homeostasis. And it is also sufficient. If you increase osteocalcin in blood, you increase adrenal steroidogenesis, whether you do it acutely or chronically. So, embryonic osteocalcin regulates lifelong adrenal growth and function. If needed, this function can be fulfilled by maternal osteocalcin, but it's a situation that does not exist in nature. Through this mechanism, osteocalcin increases its reach in physiology by reaching to functions that postnatal osteocalcin does not affect. And this represents a novel mechanism to regulate homeostasis and to prevent aging. And I'm a little bit late and I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Gerard. Do we have any questions from the audience? Otherwise, I posted a question on Slack, I know. So, with age, soft tissue calcifications are seen. Could a loss of osteocalcin with age impact calcium homeostasis in soft tissues through perhaps through aldosterone or something like that?
Aldosterone does not regulate calcium. PTH regulates calcium, and osteocalcin does not regulate PTH.
All right.
So it does not affect...
I'm very happy we cleared that up. This is my ignorance. Any other questions of Gerard? Otherwise, let's thank Gerard for his presentation.